We gave, managed to give those away, yeah. Then we have to go down through the floor.
Oh. Actually, that could add another feature here.
That's all right. Now, you see, if I were very clever, I would be singing the first verse or two of Are the Stars Out Tonight? Whether it's cloudy or bright. We're on the campus of Plattsburgh State at the planetarium talking with our, I almost hesitate to say, old friend, Dr. Glenn Meyer.
Yeah, I think that's a fair estimate, yes.
As I was driving over here this morning, my history was going past my eyes from the inside, saying, when did I first meet Dr. Meyer? What year did you come here?
Well, probably about 71 is when you'd have first run across me.
Wow. I worked on the radio, as everyone knows, for a long, long time. And occasionally we would get a little ripple of the Earth's crust, and I would call up and say, is that seismograph working over there? And it was for a while.
For quite a while.
Then it ran out of paper.
We did have some problems that time, but fortunately, I think we've gotten through quite a bit here pretty well.
It's amazing. And then I would, and then as our viewers and my old listeners would probably know, I would defer to the seismograph at Potsdam. I think theirs is still operating.
Right, they're part of the network there, and theirs definitely are still up. We had our sensor originally up at the Minor Center area, actually.
So you started working in the planetarium when you first came here?
When I first came here. Actually, strictly speaking, I was before I came here, because I was a student here at one time, and when this planetarium...
I didn't know that.
Yes.
Wow.
I was a student way back in the 60s, and I'm still a student, but a little different.
Aren't we all?
Oh, yes. But basically, when this building was built and the planetarium first went in 64, I was one of those eager students that found it a wonderful toy to play with, although I never thought I'd be playing with it long term. And then when I came back to teach here, I was asked if I would sort of look out for it. And, well, the rest is history.
Wow. I guess it long term would apply, 33 years.
At least, yes.
As we're recording this, in February of 2004, if you can believe that, I've always had a peripheral interest in the stars, but I know so very little, and I guess most people in the world just don't take time to study it, and that's too bad, isn't it?
Well, I think today most people are indoors. There's lots of other entertainment. I won't mention what types here, but basically, yes, there are fewer people out just looking at the sky. And people aren't as familiar with what they can see in the sky. We try to make people a little more aware of that.
You know, I as you were speaking, I was recalling all the times that we were camping at Coles Creek along the St. Lawrence River near Waddington on a warm July night or early August night, putting blankets out, lying down on the blankets and looking at the meteor showers and see what we could see how many things we could find that were orbiting past us as you go, and there is something mesmerizing about looking at the heavens.
Oh, there definitely is. As a matter of fact, we try to get our students out, and in the past, though we haven't done it as much in the present because we lost our associate director due to budget cuts, unfortunately.
Oh, tragic.
Yeah, Mrs. Lisa Beth Kistner used to take a lot of people out up at Pointer Rush Park.
Perfect
and we would
spot.
Spend a lot of time out there. So we've been doing a little less of that, but we'd like to get back into it at some time.
Once again, memories. What would we do without memories? As a small child, some of my earliest memories are of my father taking us from our home in Thornwood, New York, in Westchester County, to the Hayden Planetarium. And I can remember as a very small child watching the show, being completely enthralled, coming out and starting to cry, and my father said, Gord, what's wrong? And I said, the sun is out. How can the sun be out? And I can remember, I've said a lot of idiotic things in my lifetime, but I remember that one very well. That talk about a icon among planetariums.
Oh, it is. The old Hayden with its big black ant, as we often refer to those old Zeiss machines, about 12 feet long, usually painted black. Matter of fact, there's still one up at the Montreal Planetarium.
Really?
Beautiful old machine. Yeah, I, as a child, also was down there, and I know it impressed me very much. And of course, just recently with the Rose Center, they've completely refurbished also. As a matter of fact, interestingly enough, they were undergoing renovation at the same time we were, and we're using a lot of the same companies. We're a bit smaller, though.
Just a tiny bit smaller. I don't know how many people the Hayden holds these days.
I'm not sure what it's, the present center's seating capacity is. Ours is much smaller, about 49 for in here.
But it's wonderful. And early experiences here, when this planetarium first came about, raising a huge family, as Kay and I have done through the years, not being able to afford expensive outings of one kind or another to Montreal and New York City, I remember broadcasting every time you'd have something special coming here. And I'd say, come on, we're getting some tickets. We're going down to the planetarium. So my kids have fond memories. But I must say, Glenn, walking in here today, I was blown away. You have made some massive changes.
Oh, we have. We basically stripped the entire room. The only original parts of the original planetarium that's in here is the dome up above you, and that little black ring around the edge, which we call a cove, where there's some lighting. Everything else in the room was stripped down to concrete, in some cases beyond concrete.
Far beyond the concrete.
And we had all new wiring put in, and we have, the whole place is carpeted now. The machine out in the center here, this is a Zeiss projector. This is called a ZKP3. They sort of named them by size, K for Klein, small. But what they did when they built this one was put a mid-sized star field possibility in it, so that basically it acts as a mid-sized projector, even though it has a tiny size that fits in the room very well. This one, when it was built, was the 18th one they'd ever built of this general design.
Oh, no kidding.
Actually, I think, let me just look here, yes. This is planetarium number 541, since that first one they built back in Jena, way back in the 1920s. So they still build them by hand, one at a time over there. And we're lucky enough to be able to get in on a lot of the design of what we really wanted on it. And so when it came here, it had just about everything that we really wanted. It's completely computer controlled, although we can have some manual control on it. It still acts through computer systems. It projects somewhat over 7,000 stars. The old one projected about 1,300, so it gained a few extra stars in our sky. And, well, the basic projection from the two large spheres, one on the bottom and one up on the top, and see all these little what we call eyelids. Each one of those is a separate projector behind it that projects stars in one part of the sky. And then we have little parts up here that project some of the zodiac. We have some other ones that project constellation overlays, and of course these areas in here project planets. And when you put it all together, we have about 107 separate projectors on the machine, which is why we need a computer if one person is going to keep track of everything.
We'll talk about all the computers that are in operation as Glenn started flipping switches when we walked in and we heard sounds all around the room. We love it. We're going to pause for just a moment to make sure we're actually recording something on this tape. Then you're going to learn an awful lot more about Dr. Glenn Meyer and the planetarium at Plattsburgh State. Once again, we're at the planetarium on the campus of Plattsburgh State. Hudson Hall, it's called,
right? It's Hudson Hall, yes, and the planetarium's the North Country Planetarium.
The North Country Planetarium. We want to find out a little more at this stage in our show about you, Glenn. Where are you originally from?
Well, I'm from the Hudson Valley, just a little south of a town named Sorgatees, north of one named Kingston, which generally locates it, but I was born out in the countryside, basically lived out in the countryside as a child.
Always had an interest in the heavens?
From an early age, actually. I was an amateur astronomer sometime probably by junior high, if not before. At least then I was building telescopes, I remember. And I remember going out at night. There was an opposition to Mars one of those years, and I remember going on out at early hours of the morning to when it was up high in the sky. Probably my schoolwork suffered considerably, but I spent a lot of time out with telescopes, yeah.
And it evolved into your life's work?
Rather indirectly, actually.
Where'd you go to college?
Well, I started at Alfred University.
No kidding.
Yes, I did, over in the western part of the state.
And never, ever went to the Beacon Inn.
Well, funny you should mention that. We of course carefully avoided those sorts of establishments. As you probably know, at that time
Alfred was a dry town.
A dry town, that's yes. Right. And so people had to go out of town if they wished to imbibe. And the Beacon obviously was one of those places. There were a couple others. Of course, for those who don't know where Alfred is, Hornell was a town that actually was in the area, which wasn't a very large one. And a bigger one would be Corning, but that's a bit farther away.
So you went to Alfred?
I went to Alfred. Well, I went to Alfred for 2 years, and my money ran out. That tended to happen back in those days, too.
Sure did.
And I worked for a while, hadn't made an honest living, and then I went back to college, and I came up here to Plattsburgh, actually, at that time. State University had a lot to offer, including exceedingly low tuition.
When I went to the State University, there was no tuition, so I must be that much older than you. But it still was very, very
right.
low.
They were just putting tuition in when I first arrived here. I was just out working long enough, apparently. But it still was exceedingly low, and they had an excellent physics department here, and so I went into physics. And at that time, they didn't yet have their liberal arts program in place here, so what I went through, well, in order to get a degree, I had to be in teacher education. And so I took a fifth year, basically an extra year, to pick up the education courses I needed. And then I taught in an area school for a little while. Worked very briefly up at Aris Labs as a chemist, strangely enough. And then got an offer I couldn't refuse down at State University Albany.
Ah.
Excuse me there. Basically, they were willing to pay for my graduate work, and so down there I was actually in atmospheric physics. Sort of took me away from astronomy completely, and actually I worked mostly in hydrodynamics and physical limnology. And so when I first came back up here to Plattsburgh, I was primarily doing courses in physics and studies out on the lake. However, as I mentioned, Jack Perkins was a dean in those days, and he indicated that he wanted someone to take care of the planetarium, and since I was already familiar with the basic machine, my guess is his idea was that, you know, make sure it was lubricated and dusted occasionally. But I ran into a bunch of students who were just so enthusiastic that they wanted to do things. And before long, we started doing these little public shows on Friday nights. And then as the students started getting a little better, and I found that the area schools had an interest, we started doing school shows, and sort of history developed from there. So that started from the early 70s, and the same equipment that we had in here lasted right through 98, beginning of 99. So we had a long run of basically that equipment.
So you're now, and what department are you in here? The physics department?
I'm back in physics again. I say back because I've been in an assortment of departments, including earth and environmental science, geology, when it was a separate department, computer science twice for varying periods of time, and I'm back in physics. And what any of those have to do with astronomy other than the physics, you might wonder, but it's something I do.
Well, you have very broad interests, as I know, even outside of this the university setting. But you've been working in this planetarium for a long, long time, and it's got to be exciting for you to have new people come in here who've never been in a planetarium before and listen to the oohs and ahs. And
oh, it's very exciting. As a matter of fact, I think it's the children in school groups that in a way keeps one really fresh and going, because they come in, it's a new experience for them. And the nicest thing is, because in our school programs we do something different with them every year as they develop, each time they come in it's a new experience. They see something different, something that they didn't expect, a different topic. We do these all interactive, which means we get lots of chance to talk to the kids, they have lots of chance to talk to us. And yes, it's very thrilling. Just the children really are the ones that keep me going, I think.
We hope that a program such as this will be an inspiration to families all over the North Country, and this program is shown on various cable systems far and wide, to check out when the next show is at the planetarium, because I dare say that a fairly large percentage of the people who are viewing this show now have never even thought of what the word planetarium means, nor have they ever stepped inside one. So it's about time.
Well, we do have shows on usually on Friday evenings. Not every Friday evening, but during the semesters we try to have them as many Friday evenings as we can. Usually the shows are at 7, 8:30 in the evening. We have run some matinee Saturday shows in the past, but this depends on what our staffing is like. The shows we run here are usually quite a broad variety. We run what we call ephemeris shows, which are sky shows for people who are sort of interested in, after the show, going outside, looking up at the sky and trying to find out what's really going on. And then we have what we call production shows. And these are often topics that are either very timely, that like, say, an opposition of Mars, or possibly something that's going on in space, such as probes landing on Mars or going to Saturn, for example. And so we have a show based around that information. We have the good fortune of locally having a person who is the JPL solar system ambassador for this part of the country up here. And she teaches part-time at the college, Lisa Beth Kistner. And she very frequently will be adding her expertise in these. So it makes it very sort of personal and very current. We also do shows from other planetariums, ones that are major city planetariums, because our current equipment uses the same sort of operating system, say, as the Hayden Rose Center Planetarium uses. So we can exchange rather professional shows with them.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
And that was not something that was easy to do in the olden days.
No, in the olden days we had what would be considered a typical educational planetarium of the 1960s. It means it projected some stars, a few necessary lines and grids, and if you're real lucky, we had one or two slide projectors available to go with it. And today what we have is our Zeiss, which does a magnificent job projecting grid lines and images, as well as the stars, faint objects that we call binocular objects, that literally if you bring a pair of opera glasses in here and look up at the sky, you will see a lot more little stars and clusters that you just think of as a little smudge of light up there with the unaided eye. We also have 18 automated slide projectors around the room. They're all computer controlled and can sort of swap off tasks. And we also project video in here, and of course we have a sound system, and so we can do a fairly professional job these days.
It's got to be a wonderful show. Once again, every now and again, I'll get a telephone call from one of my friends saying, I got the telescope set up in the backyard, come and see whatever happens to be the phenomenon of the week, and I'll go over and see it, or I'll use some excuse like, pretty darn cold out there tonight.
Well, some of my students in astronomy lab occasionally have that excuse also, and of course it's real. Just recently, and we're taping this in the winter, just or early spring.
February 2004.
February, yes, and some of you may recall it was rather cold several times in that particular time period. So some of my students have to dress rather warmly. We take them on up on the roof, and we actually first show them things in the planetarium, and then we often let them find them in the real sky, and they find a lot more comfortable in the planetarium, but there's something gratifying about seeing the real sky.
You know, it's more difficult in metropolitan areas to see the night sky than it is here. You're fortunate to have not too many glaring city lights on the roof of Hudson Hall, or especially at Point of Rush Park.
Right. No, we're very fortunate because it's one of the things that we find from people who come here from larger cities. They are so amazed that what they see in the planetarium sky they can really see by going outside, just outside of the town, and of course the sky then is dark enough that they can see even the very faint stars.
There's so much to think about when you look at the sky. For those of us who are totally uneducated in astronomy, it boggles our minds. And for you who are familiar with all those distances and the relations of the distance with time and the way light travels, I know it still boggles your mind.
Oh, it still does. Fairly recently, the Hubble telescope was able to take some pictures that showed a couple little smudgy objects that were star clusters forming back only about 750 million years after the beginning of the universe, which that's over, you know, 13 billion years ago. That's when the light started out, and it's finally reaching us today. And so we're seeing the way things were. Probably most of those stars don't even exist today.
Yeah, and that's the part that's difficult to understand, that relationship, and how long it takes the light to get here, and what may have happened in an age that we can't even conceive of. It's amazing and wonderful.
Well, whenever you look up at the real sky, of course, you're looking back in time. If you look at the moon, you're seeing it roughly a second ago. That's about how long it takes the light to get from the moon. When you see a beautiful sunrise, you're seeing it about 8 minutes late. It takes about that long for the light to get there. When you look at the North Star at night, well, that's about 430 years ago. And we can work our way on out. There are a lot more distant things. So in a sense, we're also not just seeing things far away, but we're seeing things somewhat back in time.
You and I have grown up in an age where long before we even conceived of putting a man in the moon, there were people writing these fantastic science fiction stories about rockets, multi-stage rockets going into outer space. And then we remember the Kennedy era and making that commitment to put a man on the moon, and the man on the moon. And what a sterling moment that was in my life to remember those famous words and to see that touchdown. And now, how far we've come. And the space program ebbs and flows, doesn't it?
Right. There are times, obviously, that it gets fairly broad support. At other times, because of other pressing priorities, it just doesn't quite get the same support. But, you know, it's been a very thrilling period because coming from a period when, as you said, people like Arthur Clarke and Ray Bradbury would be writing books about what might happen, to actually sitting back and watching it really happen. And, of course, with the search for the possibility of there being past water on Mars and possibly even life in the past, if not in the present, it's a very thrilling time.
And now, as we're recording this, as I said, I believe on the 17th day of February 2004, there's been a renewed interest in probing space and perhaps sending more probes to Mars based on some rather wonderful successes up there. Huh?
We have had. Mars has been a very tough planet to land something on successfully. Of all those places that we've tried to send things, I hate to say we've had our highest failure rate with Mars, but it's true. Landing something on Mars has been difficult. On the other hand, we have had very good luck, even though the Beagle has not been found as of this date yet up there. The other two rolling probes basically are doing very nicely at this point. The orbiters are doing nicely. We're getting information back very rapidly. We also are going to be hearing a lot more, and probably by the time most people are watching this, they will have heard about Saturn, because the Cassini probe is closing in on it. This summer, it's going to be in orbit around Saturn. It's going to release the Huygens actually Christmas of this year, and over a couple weeks it will make its way down to the surface of Titan. We've never seen an organic surface, so right now in the planetarium we have some nice animations of what we think an organic surface might look like, which we'll have to get rid of in a year.
And we have to change our views of things as we get these probes closer and closer and these rovers move around the surface of Mars. Even the experts like Dr. Glenn Meyer are scratching their head every now and again, aren't they?
Oh, a lot of the time. As a matter of fact, it's really wonderful because we're discovering things on a daily basis. I know I, in the morning, often log on to some of the websites that NASA have and look at some of the new images and, as you say, scratch my head and say, is that really a sedimentary rock, or could it be a piece of schist, or what is that? And gee, I hope they get a closer view tomorrow. And of course, the wonderful thing is they do.
It's really they can wonderful. They can drill into the mound called Adirondack.
Yes. Yes, it's actually, Adirondack is rather interesting. Obviously, it's rather small compared with what we think of as Adirondacks, but still, it's very nice to have a little piece of Mars named at least after our area.
So much going on. We have so much to talk about. Before we actually get into looking at the skies here, I would like to take a moment to let our viewers know what tremendous changes have occurred here in the last 6 years or so. Mm-hmm. You just happen to have some foldable displays that we'd like to show the people. We'll get those and go about it, okay?
Yes.
We're inside the North Country Planetarium at Plattsburgh State in Hudson Hall talking with Dr. Glenn Meyer. And before we began taping today, he showed us a little bit of the history of this tremendous metamorphosis that took place a few years ago. This is incredible. I mean, to come in here and see it beautifully carpeted with these plush seats, to look around, it's just amazing and stunning and terrific. And I know it's gratifying to you. So let's go through the process and let people know where you had to go to get from there to here.
All right, let's see. Well, starting out up in here, here's a picture of basically our old planetarium. This is the way it was not that long ago, and this was taken in August of 98. And that's a Spitz A3P, a fairly standard machine of the 1960s. It was partly a pinhole projector, projected about 1,300 stars or so. And it served very well here. Here's, just going down, we have a general picture of the room. Actually, you'll see these wonderful seats, bench seats, which are covered in, I believe that was avocado naga hide, which was just the in thing at that period. Of course, we also had high-tech displays. There's a chalkboard over here.
Yeah.
And we had a computer that we moved in, which, well, it looks like one of the original PCs, basically. The way we ran the old machine was from a console, which had lots of big buttons, levers, and knobs, and looked far more impressive than our present keyboards, but kept one a lot busier doing less things, actually. Now, we started taking it apart, and the next several pictures are going to look very messy, because this is a disassembly, which happened starting in September of 98. Basically, we started tearing out wiring. We had a gentleman come in October to remove the machine, which was removed in parts. The machine, I might just mention, has found a new home with the Skyscan Corporation. There it is outside our planetarium, being waiting to be put on the truck and be packed up. We did have to remove wiring. And
look at this. Look at this shot. No one in the world would know what that was unless you told us.
Well, it looks like sort of a pit of snakes. Actually, that was the underfloor wiring we were pulling up out. And we, at that point, realized we'd had some problems in the past, and we were going to have to replace all the underfloor trackways. We left in a minimum of wiring. You can see a couple big potentiometers sitting there that were being used to still control part of the room lighting at the time. We unbolted the seats. And as you can notice, we are starting over here to take down the walls. The walls in the old planetarium were listed as a composite fiber. We discovered what the composite was, and that's why they were removed. They were actually asbestos fiber walls.
Oh, sure.
Which apparently, again, in the 60s made perfect sense, and no one realized that that's what they were. They're not friable. They're very firm.
Sure.
Basically painted over so there's no danger of them putting asbestos in the air, but we just didn't want them around anymore.
All right, we've changed batteries. Boy, we got the power now. Where were we?
I think we were just going from tearing down the walls to taking out the seats. And this is actually outside the planetarium door. We moved the seats out, and although it took us several months to sort of fulfill all the requirements to be able to donate them to other planetariums, we did manage to find new homes for them so that they're in use also. Hopefully they've been reupholstered, but maybe some of them still have the avocado naga hide. I'm not sure. After we did that, we started making other changes on the room, and one of the changes we made was to put in a new entranceway, actually an emergency exit, that we wanted to have crossed from the main entrance. The old one had been on the same wall, which was something we were never too happy about. So we cut through the walls. We also cut through the floor. Remember those wires? We had to put in new trackways, which means we had to dig up the floor, and down here you can see it's under the process of being dug up. To get a better idea of what the trench actually looked like, and you can also see we had to get down to some of that wiring that comes out of pipes that was originally buried in the concrete. And we have a wonderful electrician, Robert, here on campus, who did a wonderful job of putting in new junction boxes for us under the floor, which incidentally now have access panels so you can get actually to them without tearing up the concrete, and a large pipeway going on out here to where the machine would be. And here is, at that time, our associate director, Lisa Beth, working on the trench. I'm not exactly sure what she's doing. Looks like probably dirty and messy, and somewhat unpleasant work, but it had to be done.
Yeah.
And then we had a very happy day in December, sort of like an early Christmas present. The truck arrived with the large crates that had been airshipped into Montreal and trucked down to us. And you can see one happy person here sitting on up among the crates, because that was our Zeiss machine. It came in several parts. They had built it in Germany for about 6 months previously. And then they dismantled it, crated it up, and shipped it over, which means now we have to have the room ready when their technicians arrived. So Robert was doing massive wiring. In the meantime, outside, we made sure if we had an exit out there, we had steps going down from it. Minor point, we didn't want the exit to be 4 feet above the ground. That's a little rough on people. On down here, we started putting new walls in, and this time they were plywood. We used a lot of plywood to build what was going to be some of the towers. As a matter of fact, around the room, you can see these black towers with projectors on. And this was them taking shape. We got the crew with the carpeting in, and we started carpeting things and started putting the towers in place. And then Hans Ufert, a technician from Germany, arrived. And he started unpacking the crates, and these are parts of the machine out in the room. We found there was a little bit of assembly required.
Yes.
And
those dreaded phrases on Christmas Eve.
Yes, definitely. This one had some assembly required, and there's Lisa reading some of the instruction manuals. Actually, Hans was there, but all the help was needed, and here...
Batteries included? Yeah, batteries included.
Actually, yes, amazingly enough.
There are batteries in it?
There are batteries certain components. They're basically on the computers. There's a total of about 40 computers in the room. Most of them are embedded in equipment, so they don't look like computers. But many of them do have tiny batteries in, again, to keep their BIOS system alive for starting up. So it really does have little batteries, and it's something we have to be aware of, that from time to time we sort of quietly close the place down for several hours and go around and change little batteries.
Batteries, aha.
Here was actually the machines being assembled, and this is going to become the console that's going to run it eventually. And you can see the machine is slowly coming together here. It's looking more and more like a planetarium projector. And there is Hans Ufert in February of 99 up there adjusting the machine. Fantastic person. He spent a month here, including time where he trained us to how to take care of the machine, because Zeiss, unlike some of the companies where they like you to have a service contract every year, Zeiss believes you should be taught on site to do the basic servicing. And it works out very well. Again, you can see some of the parts we're getting into in the central part of the machine here. Lots of little gears. There's also a bit of electronics. This is in the base of the machine. Not the way most people see the base, because we usually have covers on it. But there's quite a bit of electronics and little boards in there. And here is Hans Ufert again, working on the machine. And I took so many photos of him, he insisted on this photo being taken.
I love it.
So if I look a little disgruntled at that moment, it was because he turned around and turned the camera on me. I didn't expect it. But it worked out pretty well. It recorded I was really here too. And here's some more tools and equipment. Because the next thing after the machine got in was putting in the auxiliary projectors. And this is the beginning of those. On the towers you can see these little wires that are hanging down and running around. Because we have 18 slide projectors, but actually each one has a equivalent of a PC computer built into it. And as a consequence, they all talk to each other. Every 20th of a second, they send a little nose count around and they check. So for example, if you're going to brighten six of them at once to make a collage that covers a whole ceiling, it comes up as a smooth unit rather than as a patchwork quilt.
Sure.
And they actually monitor each other's light bulbs, therefore, and what the brightness is, and adjust accordingly. So they're busy all the while.
It's amazing.
So they had to be wired in. Now you notice there's a big lift here. I said we had a sound system, which means we have theater speakers in here, which you don't see. And the reason you don't see them is they're behind the dome. But to put them behind the dome meant that there had to be some way of lifting them up and anchoring them up there. And so we had a couple of very interesting days moving speakers up behind the dome. And then finally, we set up our operating console, and I said it was a lot less impressive. You remember that one back that
I
you
sure
saw
do,
before
yeah.
with all those? Well, now we just have keyboards here and a couple computer screens. But that's how we actually run the whole planetarium, both the auxiliary equipment and the equipment there. The central panel we can use for sort of quasi-live. The one over on this side runs most of the Zeiss equipment, and the one over on this side most of our auxiliary equipment. And then seats came in. Actually, this was, you know, it was in March, and it wasn't until May that the seats came in. So as soon as we had the system up, we started using it for college labs. And so we had a lot of people coming in the labs that would sit on the floor at first because we didn't yet have seats. And then the last row, actually, these are pictures actually taken of the machine while it was in operation with the actual sky being projected up there. And obviously, we can project a lot of different types of things up on our dome. Galaxies, and of course, traditional constellation pictures.
So that was the summer of 99, so that's almost 5 years ago.
That's right. what actually, in 2000, the International Planetarium Society was having its conference in Montreal. They have one every 2 years. They usually get somewhere between 1,000 and 2,000 people from all over the world. And we were chosen as one of the post tours, which means after the main conference, we had a group of people come down here for the day to take a look at this, play with it, get their ideas on how things were working. And we had a very successful turnout, and we had a lot of people that were really very excited about this because it was the first that they'd seen a small size planetarium like this, which had the full capabilities of a big city planetarium without sacrificing any of the educational needs. Zeiss and the other companies involved did a wonderful job in actually constructing a device which could both be used for school programs right from preschool up through college level, doing all sorts of the types of things you need in a lab and school presentations, and at the same time also be able to run essentially big city planetarium type shows. And we were planning on getting in the production business, and we did a little bit, but as most of you know, there was a period where the state budget wasn't too good for a couple of years, and we had some budget cuts, and that's when our associate director was let go, term contract basically. She'd been doing a fantastic job. And at that time, we had to scale back some of our outside activities. So we're just right now starting again doing some production type work of our own for local consumption. We'd like to get back in the bigger school of it again. We have lots of opportunities, and this summer at the Planetarium Conference in Spain, we're probably going to let people know that we're starting to get back in business again up here.
I love it. They're delighted. Does your planetarium here have its own website?
We actually go through the college website at the present, although it's something we want to expand into a more complete web page. Right now it's a sort of a minimum one that shows what programs we have coming up, what's available for area schools. We also, unfortunately, the brochures aren't out today. They're out tomorrow, but doesn't help you. But we do have brochures that are sent out to schools, which, again, summarize not only the shows of the season, but also what general packet shows we have for school groups. We usually try to get word out. Well, years ago, you know, you were one of our people that we get word out through. We still do through the radio, and we also do through the local newspaper. They're very good about running little blurbs on what we're doing. Most of the area schools have been contacted, and we've had very good success with school groups coming in.
I think that's great. It's so important to perpetuate this passion. Perpetuate the passion. How do you like that, huh?
Well, actually, the school children get very enthusiastic. But more importantly, it's really interesting to watch the learning process. And of course, since I'm here a lot, I get to see the same children you often, all the way from preschool right through high school. And although probably most of the children don't realize that I recognize some of them year after year, it's just sort of interesting to watch them grow, develop, and also watch their reaction as they get a little more mature and see how they respond to things. And they're the ones that really tell me how to do the shows. Because strictly speaking, it's not a show for them. It's more of an educational experience, a virtual reality that we bring them into. But then they ultimately, along with their teacher, tell us what we should do.
We are at that point in our program where we're going to try what for hometown cable and our little corner could be the ultimate experiment. We're going to see what one of these programs looks like. Look at the sky and watch this fantastic machine in operation. I'm in total awe of how these computers work and actually bring the sky to life. And maybe, just maybe, after we finish our program today, you and your family will go outside and stand together and take a look at the sky and learn a little bit more about how it works and what we all can learn together about our sky here in the North Country. The sky is not the same all over the world, is it?
No, it's not. And as a matter of fact, we become very aware of that when we work with other planetariums, because we've worked with some of the planetariums in Australia, and of course they have the southern sky. The good news is we can emulate the sky from anywhere on the planet, actually up near Earth space as well. And we can also travel a few thousand years forward or back in time fairly easily. So we can set up the sky from different places and different times in here.
I just finished writing a column about miracles. That miracles have different meanings mm-hmm. for you and for me and for others, I'm sure. But every sunrise and every sunset to me is a miracle, especially at my age, to be able to. But I've had the luxury, and I know you have too, of seeing sunrises and sunsets at different places on this planet. And I never cease to be amazed. Even as I get up in the morning and my wife will holler at me while I'm shaving, look at this sunrise. And from down in our little hollow in Morrisonville, we can see that beautiful pink-red sky. Or if you're on Lake Champlain, when I was on the radio, I had a lady all those years who would call me up and say, "Gordy, you didn't mention the sunrise." I've been impacted by those sunrises and sunsets. We at Puerto Vallarta, we saw some beautiful sunsets a couple of years ago, just beautiful.
Well, I must admit that knowing, you know, what the science is behind it doesn't detract from the beauty at all. And it still is absolutely gorgeous to watch. I enjoy sunrises, sunsets, nights when we have aurora borealis. They're just absolutely gorgeous. And of course, some years we have some very nice ones. A good meteor shower. Lying out and watching.
You can't beat it, can you?
Oh, they are just beautiful. And the fact that one knows what's going on from a scientific point of view doesn't detract from the awe to me at all.
Don't you love to be with a little kid saying, there's another one, there's another one. I love it. There's so much to see and so much to do. Let's look at the sky as we continue our program from the North Country Planetarium. Calvin just made an astute observation. He said, if kids were to draw a picture of this and you'd see all those little eyes in there, you'd say that's overkill. And kids have drawn pictures of this.
Oh yes, and as a matter of fact, some of their drawings are absolutely beautiful because it shows what they're noticing. They all notice it's blue. That's a beginning. The color is always blue. And then they do notice it has all these little eyelids on it. And so we get lots and lots of these little circles all over, circles on circles, which I guess is what it sort of does look like.
It's amazing. All right, let's talk about how you acquired this piece of equipment and how we got from that dream stage to actually getting it installed here. That's quite a story all by itself.
Well, actually, it was a long journey. And we actually started looking at possible machines long before we had money, because we knew if we had money, we'd have to be able to make some decisions. And I had the good fortune of talking to some of the engineers from Zeiss in London, sort of halfway, well, close anyway. And so they had an idea of what we would want if we did have a machine, so they could start giving us an idea on the price and so on. Originally, when we indicated what we wanted, they indicated that they didn't think they were going to be able to do it for us. And then the next morning, the engineers met me at breakfast and said that they could do it, but we wouldn't like it. And it evolved from there, so we were working
well,
with
them.
Well,
there wasn't a bait and switch, was it?
Not quite. As a matter of fact, this machine was the first one that they tried putting the higher wattage bulbs in. They tried putting in the very dense star plates in the small machine, because we really wanted a machine that would do a bigger size machine's job. But we had to stay in a small size because of the small size of the room, so it wouldn't be blocking people's view. And so they worked out some possibilities of how to build the machine, at least as a prototype, in a sense. While this was going on, we were also trying to find funding, and Senator Ron Stafford was instrumental in this.
Bless his soul.
Oh, yes, because when he found what our needs were and we sent him the information of what we were sending out and what we were trying to do, he came and definitely supported it and wound up getting a line item in the state budget for $300,000, which of course then could be used to seed additional money as need be. So that worked out extremely well. And so at that point, we then had to make choices between different machines. There were other machines that, besides Zeiss, Spitz, the one that built our original machine, was definitely one of the machines considered. Minolta and Godo, both Japanese firms, as well as Evans and Sutherland, that builds the Digistar machines, which are a very different type of machine, totally electronic projection. We worked through them and finally rejected all of them except this one, because none of the other companies could put together the package that could do everything we wanted in one machine. And Zeiss, because of the fact they do build them one at a time, and I might also say because they have some very ingenious engineers that are willing to really try things out, I'm told that this actually machine has its second set of star plates in it. It went through a set of star plates before we ever got it.
No kidding.
Well, apparently from what Hans told me, but didn't tell me until after it was installed for 6 months and it didn't give us trouble, that he had what he called lightning in the sky when they were trying it out. The star plates cracked and suddenly you'd have a bright lightning-like streak because there's a 200-watt lamp inside of each of these little balls, and they're pretty small, and there are two cooling fans on them, but still there's enough expansion that the little glass plates that have the stars on would get over-tensioned and crack. And so they had to find a new way of mounting them to use the higher temperature lamp and still have them survive. And so there was a lot of innovation on this machine. Hans was laughing about the fact that two machines that were in some ways prototypes were actually going out in the field in New York State at the same time, because the one in the Rose Center, Hayden, was being installed at the same time, and it was a one-of-a-kind machine. Now, I might mention this is not a one-of-a-kind any longer. There still is, incidentally. But there are two more that of the ZKP-S, as they call it now, models out there in the world. So now we're one of three of this particular subtype and one of about, 20-some-odd watt total of this general frame type.
We're very impressed, and we can't wait to see it in action, so let's do that now. All right, Glenn, we're going to do the best we can here, whatever the camera shows. We'll at least pique their curiosity.
Okay.
So you tell us what we're seeing.
All right, this is actually a collage of slides that are projecting all over the dome, and we're looking at basically our logos. He was looking at the old planetarium, the A3P that we had for many, many years up through 98. And of course, our logo, North Country Planetarium. We also have Gateway to the Universe. That was coined actually by some students back when we first started going in the 70s with school groups. And we've always kept it as, in a sense, we are a little gateway to the universe.
Yes, we are. It's difficult. The human eye is an amazing mechanism, isn't it?
And
what's even more important is the brain to interpret all those signals that are coming
definitely.
In.
Oh, definitely. All those images that we see, like we're covering the sky now with a large part of, actually this is part of the remnant of the Vela supernova explosion. There was a star that exploded and these wisps of gas are actually ones that spread out from it. And we're just covering our whole dome with a big sort of picture that covers everything as if you were right in it. There's also now, that's Phobos, one of the moons of Mars, which is incongruously floating out there, but this is sort of a collage of things, so they don't necessarily really fit together astronomically. They just sort of look pretty together.
How big is this dome in diameter?
The dome's actually only 24 feet across. It's a fairly small dome. We seat about 49 people in here. But of course, there's another planetarium director from New York City reminded me that once it gets dark, all domes are the same size.
Isn't it amazing?
It is.
I love it.
Well, now we've taken away some of that picture, and we have an earth up there just to remind everyone where they're from. And since we have an earth up, we're going to have to add a few other sort of planetary objects up there.
That's the sun.
There's the sun, yes. And around you is the peak of Mauna Kea in Hawaii. That's where actually the world's largest observatories are. And all the way around the room, there are imagery right now that was taken in Hawaii. These are actually taken by the Bishop Planetarium in Hawaii, so they're real ones.
And, I should mention that some people from the North Country had no small part in helping to build those telescopes down there, and boy, what they've given us is pretty neat stuff.
They're really beautiful. Of course, there is something we use with children, a nice Great Bear with stars. And we have lots and lots of galaxies, and we've decided to just cover our dome with pictures of them. Most of these happen to be spirals. We actually live in a small cluster of galaxies ourselves, a local group. It only has a few dozen members, but the Virgo cluster, which this actually would be part of here, have well over 10,000 members. So there are really big galactic groups out there. Of course, each of those galaxies would have hundreds of billions of stars. And again, since we're just combining imagery, we'll find that we're going to add some other types of imagery here. And now we have a nice scene which might have come from the Orient in the past. One of our shows not too long ago was The Stars of Jade, where we looked at Chinese astronomy, particularly during the period when Europe was having the Dark Ages. They're pretty active. And actually, some of these scenes around you now were part of that particular show, where we have some very nice artwork in the typical Oriental style, forming a skyline and a horizon.
And these are all slides.
These are all slides we're just using now, and we have a bunch of spacecraft up there.
There are lots of them up there, aren't there?
Oh, there are. Some of these are real and some are imaginary. Children in here are quick to pick out which is which. Adults usually take a little bit longer, but when we ran this before a show, the reaction of the children to all of these was really well worth watching.
Was it?
Particularly with some of the scenes that are going to come up, because since I left some of the spacecraft up, which are science fiction spacecraft, and the children seem to know that, we next decided to put up some imagery of what sorts of beings might be out there. And of course, this always gets very speculative. These are more than speculative images.
I love it. We're not sure exactly how much the camera can pick up, but
right.
Whatever it is, I'm sure people can use their imagination.
Well, these images actually were ones we used in a show that was built on Isaac Asimov's, one of his,
what a guy,
his
huh?
stories, where he has a interesting race of beings that have three sexes. To get something that looks a little bit more familiar, we'll dissolve those out and bring up things that at least is more recognizable as what we think of as aliens.
Oh my goodness.
And of course we have to have cute furry ones too.
Oh. We're gonna give Calvin a workout. He won't need his yoga lesson when he finishes here today.
No, we're going all over the dome with these, and that's the advantage. And he's already, you see, missing the fact that now we're on a mountaintop looking at the clouds around us.
Oh, yes.
With 18 projectors, even when we just use the slide projectors, we can pretty much cover the dome several times over. I think he's right now getting a moon, nice crescent phase, showing the old moon and the new moon's arms. And then there are a few other moon-type pictures too. And We also have a Jupiter about the way it would appear through a small telescope. It's a big fuzzy light ball with a couple of little moons out on the sides of it.
It's over on the right-hand side.
Right, and of course by now we're also getting some nebulas and some galaxies and other things in here.
Once again, we're straining the camera's capabilities. The human eye is doing a magnificent job, and hopefully the camera's eye is capturing enough of this.
We'll have to see what it captures. If necessary, we might be able to brighten things up a bit.
And I think it's doing great. Of course, for many of us as children, we could only imagine what these things looked like, and as adults now, we're getting a much clearer view on
it. Oh, it is amazing, because a lot of the imagery that we project here in the planetarium are things that, of course, when both of us were youngsters, didn't even exist as images, and some of them are very up to date, because what we do is we download directly from some dedicated NASA websites right here in the planetarium. Onto our computer systems, and so when the things are happening in space, we have up-to-date pictures. As a matter of fact, when there were some large aurora outbreaks, we were actually using live pictures of the sun from the SOHO Orbiting Observatory, which people were seeing them in here just 5 minutes after they were actually happening.
Don't so you love it?
It was fantastic. We could project that right almost real time on the dome for people.
It never snows in here either, does it?
No, as I tell a lot of the people, because we often start in an afternoon sky with children's groups with the sun up for them to get the idea of the motion of the sun, and we usually have some puffy white clouds. And the nice thing is that we can always have a partly cloudy afternoon and a nice colorful sunset, and then the clouds all clear up by evening for the stars to come out.
Of course
they do. It always
works
beautifully in here. Now, if we could just get that outside.
We're always listening to the sky, aren't we?
Oh, we are. As a matter of fact, we also use those big radio antennas sometimes as radar by pulsing out signals. And that way, the Arecibo Laboratory was used earlier this year to bounce signals off the moon Titan of Saturn and be able to determine that it had what I'll call land masses, although at over 200 below zero, they may be ice masses, and apparent oceans. And at that temperature, we know they're not water oceans. And so it's kind of thrilling. We're waiting to see what happens, and by the time some of the viewers are watching this, they may actually already know what happens, which is part of the wonder of this age.
All right, we're underway again. We pause for just a moment to get a different perspective. This is terrific, and once again, where we determined ahead of time that we weren't able to show you precisely what people coming to the planetarium would see. The camera's eye wasn't sharp enough to pick up the tiny stars. So we're doing the next best thing, but I think that's all right, because hopefully we will have whetted their appetite to bring them in here to see, get the full shot, huh?
Well, basically what they're seeing is 18 of our projectors, and there's 107 more of them on the machine for them to see when they come in. So they're seeing just sort of a quickie view of a few of the images that appear up in our sky at times.
Most of these things won't be shown in your downtown movie theater. Most of these won't be shown except for small pieces of them on any television channels. So if you get an opportunity to come here to the North Country Planetarium with your family, please do so. And there's something for people of all ages, right?
Oh, very definitely. We have shows that are actually designed for the youngsters, as well as some that, I hate to call them adult shows, that tends to have a different connotation. However, basically aimed for the slightly older people, but most of our shows are suitable for a broad range of ages. And we do try to keep up to date. These things you see around you, like you may have just seen part of Mars, and obviously those images are images that we continuously download, make into imagery for here, and then updated. As a matter of fact, one of the shows that we're doing this season is involving us getting the latest imagery, and so every morning we log onto websites and see what's just come back from Mars to find out what our show is going to be.
How is it that the ancients were so astute when it came to astronomy?
Well, I think there are a couple reasons. First of all, it was important to them. It was something that to regulate their calendar they had to look at. The seasons were very important. And of course, the other thing is they didn't have the modern, shall we say, convenience of street lights, things to do that takes you inside in bright lights at night. So they had a lot more time to watch the sky, and they did work out an amazing amount of information about just how planets moved, how the sky could be used as a calendar, things that most people today don't even think of.
The way that knowledge expands exponentially as time goes on with modern technology, it still is amazing to us that these people who lived so many thousands of years ago could develop a fairly good working knowledge of what was going on up there over long periods of time.
It is. Actually, what is very remarkable is if we look at the ancient world, they're able to predict eclipses by a method known as the Saros cycle, knowing that eclipses tend to repeat themselves every 18 years, 11 and a third days, which means you don't see it in the same place because of that one-third day, except for every three of these cycles. Now, if it were completely clear, they might have a chance of getting a lot of the eclipses. However, you recognize that they're going to have records probably for centuries from several locations to put together to work out that cycle, which means in the ancient world there's enough communication, enough very long-term record keeping, that we find the ancients had this ability, which incidentally was temporarily lost in Europe. So it was rather interesting.
And part of the, you know, it's difficult with archaeology and so on to go backwards and determine what original intent was. And we've come up with some pretty cockamamie ideas about the monoliths and Stonehenge and the pyramids and so on. Some of them are directly out to lunch, and some of them might have some possibility within the realm of reality.
Well, that's very true. We're obviously something like the large monoliths, because they didn't have a written language, we're stuck with looking at artifacts and hoping we can figure out why they made them. The nations that had a written language, ancient Egypt, Mesopotamia, Babylonia, we have a little better idea because they wrote down, and by good fortune we have some of their writing, so sometimes we can say, oh, that's why they did it, or that's how they did it. Unfortunately, cultures that didn't have a written record, we have to do a lot more guessing about.
Some of the old libraries were destroyed, unfortunately.
Yes. Unfortunately, the libraries obviously blossomed right about the time of the Roman Empire, but at the end of it, many of them, not just the Alexandrian Library, many other ones as well, were destroyed or at least taken apart piecemeal, and many of the records lost.
We got something else coming up, or is that the end of that one?
I think that's the end of that.
All right. We'll pause for a moment. Oh, I like that inside Saturn's rings.
That is a rather nice one. Of course, this is actually an artist's conception. We're not going to actually send a spacecraft directly into the rings for probably obvious reasons. Those chunks range in size from just sand grain size up to about the size of automobiles. And they're all orbiting, of course, around the planet at rather goodly speed.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
And let's see, would you like to zoom over the surface of a planet?
Sure.
Okay, let's do a flyover here. And I'm going to make a quick modification on that too, since I'm starting to get a little better feeling for where some of the limitations may be. And this is going to just give you a little more of an edge. Okay, we're going to open up a screen and we're going over part of Venus. So we'll open the screen on our dome. And we'll start moving. This actually is real surface topography of Venus. It was generated by using a lot of the radar imagery that came back from the orbiting probes that NASA sent out. From the radar imagery, we have the topography. The color actually is coming from the imagery that came back from some of the Russian landing probes that landed on the surface. There's no probe that stays very long on Venus, at least in functioning order, because the temperature is about 900 degrees on the surface.
You can understand why.
Right. And so basically, we're looking at it minus its atmosphere here. It would actually be very cloudy, and we've gotten rid of all the clouds. It's a lot of erosion you can see over that hill right there. The erosion looks like it'd be water, but of course at 900 degrees it's not water. It's just the air on Venus is about 90 times thicker than the air on the Earth. There's a neat sort of pillow-like feature. It's called a batholith. Basically, it's where lava flowed in under the surface or puffed up the surface. You don't have to go all the way to Venus to see one. Just go up to Montreal, right in the center of the city, the park, Mount Royal. That large hill actually is the top of an old batholith. So a lot of the same geology we find on the inner planets. And so we can sort of relate them to Earth.
I can't describe for you the feeling I get in my stomach as that thing moves around. It's so interesting. That's amazing.
Yeah, so I'm sure people looking at a small screen will probably have a much calmer effect on their tummy than we have in here. Actually, we try to keep motions to a minimum in here anyway. Let's see, what else do we have? Why is Venus so hot? This is a silly little graphic that we put together. It's called the greenhouse effect. Of course, Venus isn't really in a greenhouse, but its atmosphere is almost totally carbon dioxide. And although I know there are debates about greenhouse gases, there's no debate on Venus. It has a thick atmosphere of carbon dioxide, and so the sun's energy comes in, but the heat energy doesn't get out very well, and hence a 900 degree temperature. And let's see what else we can spook up here quickly that would stay in one place and be fairly bright and neat looking. Let's see. What do we want to do? Do you want to do anything for small children?
Anything.
Yep, doing a quick setup here. And actually what this is going to be is a silly little thing that we do with young children in the planetarium. And let me brighten them all up a bit. I'm going to have to go down through and make a change all the way through, because I think you're going to want more brightness than what we're giving you here. Well, actually, I'll show you what the brightness is here. I think you want something brighter than that, right?
You can.
I can brighten it real easily. Okay, you're going to see framing on this, but that shouldn't be a problem with what we're doing here. So you just have to, I'm going to step through this, and it's going to basically just take a couple moments here, and then they'll be up brighter once I finish doing this. Yeah, what we do with young children here.
Just a second, as soon as it comes on. Okay.
Okay, with quite young children, we often have the concept of a constellation. And most children, this is about kindergarten level, are used to playing dot to dot. And of course, the first thing they recognize is they can play dot to dot with stars, but something's missing. Because when they play dot to dot, the dots have numbers on them. So we put some numbers on them. And then we ask the children, what number do you start with? And of course, by that age, they all are very wise and tell me number one. And we start counting our way around the constellation. And we start adding basically a line. And about this point, they start trying to guess what they're seeing up there. And there are several images, and we get some pretty wild guesses and some pretty good ones. And then we continue our line a bit further and see if they can figure out what we're looking at. By now, we usually get some takers. And we continue on. And depending on which one you're looking at right now, you may be seeing a fish, okay. Because actually we're having a fish, a butterfly, and a snail around the dome, so that children, wherever they're looking, will have something in front of them to look at. But of course, children's imaginations are such that once they've seen it, they don't need the numbers anymore. They can do it without the numbers. And then we let their imagination just get a little bit better, which means they start seeing the fish up there, if that's what they're looking at. And of course, we wind up having something like this. And then we can go to some of the real constellations. And so we start out usually with sort of these artificial ones, and we let the children build their constellations. Let's see what else would be interesting here. There comes the other ones. There are more yellow stars. They're more sun-like. And if you look at them, you'll even see they have things that look like sunspots and flares and the sorts of things we think of with our sun. Of course, to the unaided eye, Castor appears just to be a single star. With a telescope, you can spot the six, but don't expect to see them moving around this fast. They actually take centuries to complete their big orbits. And let's see. Just moving quickly here to pick up. Probably for your frame.
Oh, we got to go ahead. The Crab Nebula.
Okay, the Crab Nebula is actually up in Taurus, and it was a supernova explosion that was observed back in 1054 by some of the Chinese astronomers. Now, a supernova starts out by having a large star in its very last days. So if we had a large, bright blue star, as it aged, it basically would use up more and more of its hydrogen. When the hydrogen in the core was exhausted, you'd start having what's called shell burning, where basically helium begins to be fused into heavier elements, hydrogen outside is fused, and you get a lot more energy out. The star swells up, expands into a red supergiant. Now, the red supergiant is using up energy very rapidly and building up iron in the core. The iron core, when it gets large enough, is unstable and collapses. It implodes, which results in the star flying apart in a supernova explosion. And of course, the debris from that extends out in all directions. But right in the center, a collapsed star called a neutron star still remains. It spins very, very rapidly, almost like a skater when arms are being pulled in, basically increases the rate of spin. They often spin about once a second. And of course, in our sky, what we see is basically the splatter that remains of what used to be the star, the Crab Nebula. Mini sequence there. Okay. You can look at mythology and cosmology of other peoples in the past, as well as the present. In ancient India, people thought of the world as sort of being a large disk with mountains and all the features on it. But of course, the question is, what supported it? And so they had it supported by four giant elephants, strongest things they probably knew. But what supported the elephants? Well, they were on the back of a giant sea tortoise. And what supported the sea tortoise? Well, great ocean. And where did all that go? Well, there was a great serpent around the ocean. And of course, the serpent was actually what they saw in the sky as the Milky Way. A little different than our present day view, but quite charming.
Very, very interesting.
Well, basically, the Big Bang. Initially, simple atoms were formed, gases, galaxies, star clusters expanding outward in all directions. And then we'll focus in on a few of the groups of galaxies in their formation. you're actually seeing our local group, and that might be our galaxy up there. And what we usually do when we do this sort of thing is we wind up with our normal night sky, which I know I've already been told that you're probably not going to quite see because we don't quite have sensitive enough optics here on the camera. But if you come here to the planetarium, you'll be seeing, at this point, somewhere in the neighborhood of 4,000 stars.
We can see them right now with our naked eye, and it's pretty incredible. And the ancients actually tried to count the stars, didn't they? Huh?
Yes, indeed. And as a matter of fact, if you try to go out and count the stars, depending on how far away from city lights you get, typically you'll get 1,000, perhaps a little over. If you're on the Adirondacks, you make it up to between 2,000 and 3,000. Though actually, most people think they're seeing a lot more than that. Of course, there are lots and lots and lots of stars that are just a little too faint to be picked out with the eyes. And if you use binoculars, you suddenly increase your chances of counting literally tens of thousands of stars.
An amazing presentation, and I hope the camera's eye caught most of it and that our viewers enjoyed it. As you may have guessed, if you've been watching from the beginning, we're talking with Dr. Glenn Meyer, the North Country Planetarium at Hudson Hall on the campus of Plattsburgh State here in Plattsburgh. Many of you probably were unaware that we have this wonderful planetarium here, and we hope you discover it. We said in the beginning of our interview, Glenn, that time and space boggle our minds, all of our minds.
Oh, yes.
And for some of us, it's just overload. But we still have questions. As long as there is mankind, there will be questions.
There are indeed. People, obviously, in ancient times had their views of the universe. Here, we compress the universe considerably into a 24-foot dome. But out in reality, we have to recognize it stretches on out perhaps somewhere in the neighborhood of between 13 and 14 billion light years, which means, of course, that the light from the very edges started out 13 to 14 billion years ago, which means we're looking back in the past. So whenever you look out at night, you're looking at all different times. Some of the stars you see in the night sky might not even be there anymore.
And that's quite likely.
Quite likely. Stars do have a finite lifetime, and I'm saying that, which usually starts worrying people because somewhere along the way someone said, our sun is a star. Yes. Basically, we think we have another about 4 billion years to figure out what our escape plan is going to be.
We plan to be around a long time, but that may be pushing the envelope, if you will. So, Calvin says, what would happen if you could take a snapshot right now? That would be impossible.
Well, actually, a snapshot in the sense of actually seeing now would be impossible. A snapshot in seeing going back in time as we look out is quite possible. And as a matter of fact, that's being done. People are using telescopes to take what we'll call slices of the universe, looking in one direction, carefully mapping where the galaxies are. And one of the things they've found is that instead of groups of galaxies just being random, they look like almost a web work or a foam of soap bubbles as far as a structure in the universe. And this is quite remarkable because here we're dealing on a very, very large scale with structures that involve entire groups of galaxies stretched over literally billions of light years. And right now our snapshot's not of the whole sky. We have a few slices here and there that we're slowly trying to build up.
Astronomers are generally very humble people because what we've been talking about today is tremendously humbling thoughts. Mm-hmm. And when we did put astronauts into orbit initially and they looked back on the orb, perhaps they got a perspective of some of the views we've seen here today. They described it as being tremendously humbling, and it made them worry a lot less about their overdue power bill than it did when they got up there.
Yes, except I seem to recall one had an income tax problem, but which fortunately he was out of country, so that took care of it. But Yes, there's, I'm sure, something about standing on the moon and looking back and seeing the Earth as just a little ball there in space and realizing here's where all of humanity is. Everything that we know, all of our culture, everything on this one little speck in this vast universe. And in a sense, that doesn't make it less special. That makes it even more special because everything that we know is here. And the more we see outside, in a sense, the more we realize how special our own planet is. And in a sense, by going out into space and looking at other worlds, the more we can see sometimes of what perhaps would be a good way of trying to, if you wish, husband our own planet, take care of it, care for it, what might be happening in the future, what would be the best courses of action. We see a planet like Venus, which had a runaway greenhouse effect, something we wouldn't want to see here. We see places out in space where planets have gone through other processes geologically. Do they give us a hint on what's happening on our own planet that we might be able to, if not modify, at least be ready for?
I've mentioned on this program at least 2,000 times, one of my favorite words is perspective. And we hope we've given you a little bit of perspective today because, you know, this takes a stepping back a little bit from your initial focus almost to the extreme because we're stepping way, way back. Calvin asked you in the beginning about your view of the universe and you said flat. And that may take people a little bit by surprise. Explain why.
Well, basically, I was speaking of in terms of a four-dimensional space-time universe. On a very large scale, it appears flat in four dimensions. Now, that doesn't mean things don't curve in three dimensions, that we're living on a ball, the planets are spheres or very close to them. And as we look out at galaxies, obviously three-dimensionally, there's all sorts of shape. But originally, there was a question as to whether our universe might actually fold back totally upon itself or spew out in a rather strange saddle-like shape if you want to think of a two-dimensional surface bent through a third dimension. But it appears on a very large scale that it is pretty flat, which means it's a little bit simpler in some ways than some of the models. But right now, quite frankly, we don't have really good models that describe everything.
But you have to interject the concept of time. And time, for those of us who have to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and hope to go home by 5 o'clock at night, has a very special meaning. For astronomers, it has a different meaning altogether.
Well, of course, astronomers have those same situations of having to get up in the morning and so on. And we all live in the same basic, if you wish to think of it, gravity field of the Earth. We're all traveling at the same speed relative to each other, very close to the same speed in the universe, so we all share the same time. However, as soon as we start having a probe that moves at a very high speed away from the Earth, the time on that probe is slightly different than the time back here on Earth. Likewise, if we ever have a probe that gets into a very powerful gravitational field, the time there will be running slightly different. And the truth is, we can actually see this with some of the high-speed probes like the early Pioneers, the Voyagers, the Cassini, the Galileo that we sent out in space. That their onboard clocks are just slightly different than the same clock here on Earth in a predictable way. So we know that time is a factor, but most of us in our daily life are not going to notice it. Flying an airplane at that speed across the Atlantic means that you perhaps have a few billion billionths of a second difference in your time than what you would have had otherwise, which is pretty insignificant in our lifespans.
That's why we're wishing we could get out there fast enough to stop time when we go to some of the faraway planets and then come back to Earth and see that things have changed considerably. Asimov and all those guys had some very, very interesting conjecture about time.
Well, it is a favorite, I think, in science fiction. Of course, you have the problem of how you get the energy to actually do it. But in that sense, the Andromeda Galaxy is about 2 million light years away, actually about 2.5 million. If you could travel at almost the speed of light to get out there, you could basically live through the trip because it might only take you a dozen years or so. And then if you turned around and came back, it would only take you perhaps another dozen years, so perhaps less than 25 years for your whole trip. However, if it's 2.5 million light years out you've traveled and back on Earth, about 5 million years would have changed. And that means you might not recognize your street, and as indeed the people might not recognize you as human at that point. It's kind of a scary thought.
There are a lot of things that are scary, especially when people think of the Milky Way as the whole universe, and that's not even a tiny corner of it.
No, our galaxy is just one of very many, although it has somewhere in the neighborhood of perhaps 100 billion stars in it. And today we know that a lot of stars have planets around them. We're discovering new planets around other stars at the rate of several a month at this point. I remember at a planetarium show not too long ago, we were having some numbers of planets outside the solar system, and we were counting them sort of on our fingers. Now we're, you know, well past 100 and climbing rapidly, and basically we're learning that there are lots of other solar systems. We know very little about the planets yet. It's hopefully with the Webb telescope in the future, in the next decade, we'll start being able to actually get some idea of what type of atmospheres some of these worlds have, see if any of them have that magic combination of oxygen and water in their atmosphere, which for most of us would say, hey, that's a spot there might be something alive. Whether it be anything that would want to talk to us or not is another matter.
Mars has always been just close enough for us to titillate our imaginations, and yet so far away that we couldn't learn much about it until fairly recently. And now we're learning so much almost every day that it's hard to keep up with it. Isn't that incredible?
It is incredible, and what you said about Mars being titillating was absolutely true, because some of the planets like Venus were cloud covered, so we could imagine what was underneath, but we couldn't see. With Mars, through telescopes, early astronomers could see features and they knew it was Earth-like.
Canals.
Canals, yes. An unfortunate translation from the original canali, which simply meant channel. Percival Lowell had lots of canals on Mars. He also had some on Venus and Mercury, although we don't usually talk as much about those. And of course, I think in the first half of the 20th century, most people were pretty sure that we were going to find some type of life, and quite a few people were expecting to find something that you might be able to shake hands with.
War of the Worlds.
Yes, and of course, when the first Viking landers landed, that was one of the big ideas, was to try to find if there was life, and they came back with a qualified maybe, and didn't find any critters, however, running around them, hopping, or anything like that. And I think that disappointed a lot of people. But the fascination, of course, was brought up again not too long ago with some meteorites that came from Mars that appear to have what might be fossil evidence of bacteria in them. And the question is, if these indeed are bacteria, and a fair number of people think they could well be, does this mean that very simple bacterial life existed on Mars in the past? And of course, also the discovery that there was water on Mars in the past, a big ocean apparently in the northern polar region. And that's, of course, right now part of the job of the Spirit, and to go around and try to actually sample the rocks, see what looks like might have been formed by water, as water being something that, at least here on Earth, we much associate with life and is needed for life as we know it. I mean, everyone would just love to roll up to a rock and see a fossil in it. I don't think any of us are expecting that. On the other hand, again, Mars is very much sort of the mystique.
It
may be an abode of life, although today we know there might be other abodes of life. The moon Europa, for example. And that was one of the reasons for the Galileo probe being essentially burned up into the atmosphere of Jupiter rather than leaving it orbiting, because it was not sterilized appropriately for landing on a surface somewhere. And once it was found that Europa and some of the other moons might have some form of life under their ice, it was important not to just leave it out of control orbiting after the fuel oil ran out, where it might collide with one of the moons. And so the safest thing to do was, of course, burn it up in Jupiter's atmosphere.
It's amazing the things we have to think about, isn't it? And now, as we're recording this on the 17th day of February 2004, we are doing some wonderful things. We've got machines rolling around the surface, not covering miles, mm-hmm. but feet and tens of feet on Mars, making new discoveries. And President Bush has made a commitment mm-hmm. to the future that's for you and for others right. of your ilk is a little bit encouraging.
Oh, it is encouraging that basically, again, there appears to be an incentive to try to push out into space. And we have to look at a balanced approach, though, because not just, obviously, it's very oh, dramatic when people go out. And I certainly would not ever say we shouldn't have human exploration. On the other hand, we need probes first to try to get the basic information to make sure that when people get out there, they have some idea what they're going to run into. And of course, that was done with pre-Apollo days with the moon. There were numerous craft that were sent out, including small surveyor landers, to actually explore some of the features of the moon so that when the men came to the moon, they had a good idea of what to expect in very general terms as far as safety and the like.
Safety is always a factor.
Very much so.
And that's why we've probably had some disappointments at Mars. It's a long ways away. We also had a few major computer glitches.
Yes.
And to me, it's incredible that we were, I say we collectively, mm-hmm. Were able to solve those problems and get that thing going again.
Well, we were fortunate because the nature of the problems were ones that didn't involve really hardware breakdowns, which obviously we can't send a technician out there for. But a software problem, sometimes patches can be downloaded, and that was a fortunate thing.
But once again, there is a time differential between here and Mars, and knowing when to start the little drill in the rock.
It is very much, and you mentioned earlier that, you know, it's not traveling miles a day, but it's traveling feet a day, and this is part of the reason, because by the time a signal from it gets back to Earth, let's imagine the signal is indicating it's about ready to bump into something or fall off something, by the time we get a message back, we're almost a half an hour too late, at which point it's not going to do much good. So its onboard computer has to take care of the standard features of picking out subroutes, and we have to give instructions for short distances where we've already looked at the territory ourselves ahead of it, and usually you notice we send it a short distance and have it stop and sort of take a quick survey of what's around it. Now that also gives us more science, but it also gives us a safety that we're not going to suddenly drop a wheel into something that it can't get out of.
You've given us a great primer today. I hope that there are people of all ages who have gained a little more insight than they had when this program began into why you're so interested and passionate about what's going on in other worlds besides our own. What advice for young people would you have now? Let's say a 10 or 12 year old is saying, "Dad, where can I go? How do I get started?" Would you suggest doing some research, coming to a show here, or what?
Well, I suggest several things. Obviously, coming to shows here, checking in at the college, we can give you some specific information, some pointers. Coming in and looking at various things that we show here. But the other thing, and I know this isn't going to be nearly as popular, but it's important for the student also to try to do well in school, particularly in areas like math, science, and here comes the unpopular one, English. Because it's necessary to be able to write fairly well along the way. A lot of people overlook the fact that when scientists make discoveries, if they can't communicate it, it's not going to work very well. And so it's very important that you get those basic skills. Try to take all the math you can, the science, make sure you are doing well in English if possible, and that's, I know, the one that usually most people in science tend to hedge a little away from. And don't forget to go out and look at the real sky. A small telescope is a wonderful thing for someone around 10 years old to get out with. I know when I was young, that was one of the things that got me started, was looking out the real sky and saying, wow, it's really there. There's one thing to see these nice presentations in planetariums and see these wonderful photographs and the images coming back from a spacecraft, but it's a whole other view when you look through the eyepiece of a small telescope and Saturn may be sort of blurry and wiggly through the atmosphere, but my goodness, there are rings around it. And I can see a little division in the rings. You look up at the moon and there are really mountains there and craters and a little valley. And before long, they start learning a little geography of the moon. There's something just the gee whiz of actually saying, I saw it through my own eye, and it was a real thing that I don't think can ever be surpassed.
We, like the ancients realized, and why we know today, we're affected by things that happen in space.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly affected by gravity.
Oh, yes.
It's always been an interesting study of mine. Because wouldn't we all love to be able to control the gravity? in our lives.
Oh, yes.
Besides building up our muscles to be able to jump higher and run faster, it would be a wonderful thing. And we're starting to get a handle on what gravity is all about, but there's still mysteries involved.
Oh, very much. We have some very different descriptions of gravity that are still very competing. One description which basically treats it at the atomic physics level as a basic force-carrying particle, graviton, some people would call it, which has yet to be discovered, I might add. It's one of those few of the subatomics that have never been discovered but predicted. And other people think you'll probably never find it because actually it's just a curvature of space through time caused by mass, which works very well in describing the very big things. And so we wind up having two very different descriptions, neither of which most people think of if they slip and fall and scrape their knee.
I love it. Where do you stand on the theoretical level in terms of, you spent a lot of years studying these things. What are some of your private thoughts that you may not dare to publish yet about what all this means? Do you have any?
Oh, I have a scattering of thoughts, but I don't think they're anything all that radical, really.
You know, because it's something that you can project, you can read extensively, you can form an opinion, and then hope that science will catch up with you.
Well, right now in science, large picture, there's a lot of effort to try to get what might be called the theory of everything. One model that works from the very tiny subatomic world right up to the universe. And there's a lot of effort that's been going into that. Einstein, in his later years, tried to combine it and never made it.
Yeah.
And there's been a lot of people ever since trying different models using brains, strings, other conventions to try to bring together these models. We may have a fundamental problem that we're using models that have different basic concepts to start with that we're trying to put together. And the truth is, when we build a model, we're doing it with this little bit of wetware we have up here, which is pretty small compared to the universe.
Yeah.
And we're building it on our experience. And we've experienced physical things, particles and so on, baseballs, whatever. We've also experienced wave motion. We have some idea of that. Curvature of things. But what if the basic foundation is something that is just completely beyond any of our sensory apparatus? And so we don't have yet a little model somewhere in this wetware that says this is what we can attach it to. And so we may be stuck with multiple models for quite a few years. And I'm not sure that's always necessarily bad. It may not indicate that the universe can't decide what it's supposed to be. It probably means that we just aren't yet quite to the point that we can understand it.
There,
gives us something, you know, it's good employment, basically.
There might be more chaos out there than we want to admit.
Well,
there is chaos.
There is, and as a matter of fact, there's also wonderful order. There are, right now, obviously, we're looking at a lot of things. We know that there have been major changes on the Earth due to objects from space. We think, for example, a whole dinosaur and many other creatures got wiped out about 65 million years ago that way. Today we're actually watching what might be called vaguely threatening objects, and there's a website actually which indicates potentially dangerous asteroids that are being tracked day to day and what distance they're going to pass of the Earth.
Movie makers and love that.
Oh, they love it so far, and newspapers love it. I notice whenever one gets up in the few thousandth of a percent possibility of hitting, which is quite low, but nonetheless it disturbs people considering the sheer damage that could be done. On the other hand, it also gets people thinking about, well, if we do spot one years in advance, what can we do about it? So in a sense, today at least we're looking at it from a standpoint of if we know what's going to be happening, there are sometimes things we can do to minimize at least the damage.
You know,
the human race has this tendency that would like to be around a bit longer, and compared to things like the dinosaurs, we're just infants anyway.
We love to think about life on other planets. We've talked a lot about science fiction. We realize, of course, that these guys who wrote the best science fiction were pretty good prophets, actually.
Right. As a matter of fact, many of them were also pretty good scientists, because we have people like Isaac Asimov, who was a biochemist, Arthur Clarke, who actually laid out the ground rules, basically, of artificial satellite communication systems long before. other people going way back. Jules Verne, obviously, was also interested in science at many levels. And if we go way back to what might arguably be the first science fiction novel, was written by Johannes Kepler. Basically, the dream is what it translates into. It was concerning a journey to the moon. And of course, back in the 1600s, that had a slightly different view than today. But the fact that Kepler also was a person who worked out elliptical orbits for the solar system and was doing some very serious work, and he also decided to try his hand at fiction. And so it's not surprising that some of these people come up with ideas that actually bear watching.
I love it. There's nothing wrong with a lot of good, serious thought. Unlock your mind. Get it out of the confines of your little microcosm of the mundane life that most of us lives. We talked before about paying our taxes and getting up in the morning, and just do some thinking. I hope this program has inspired all of you to do that. Glenn, thanks so much for inviting us over. We finally caught up with you and finally did this. We hope this is the first of many chapters, because you and I and Calvin plan to be around here for a long time to come. Thanks for having us here.
Well, thank you for coming on in, and I definitely hope you can come on back and we can do some other things here in the planetarium.
We can promise you that we will. And who knows where we're going to be next time in the universe for our little corner.